Hello and a very good afternoon to you all. This is Solu Gautam and today on behalf of Mirai team, I'll be hosting the current session and I extend a very warm and hearty welcome to each one of you connected with us through our iTalks webinar. Well, I would like to thank you all for taking the time out from your heavy schedule and marking this program with your glorious presence. Thank you for joining with us. And also don't forget to subscribe our YouTube channel for being updated to our programs even in the days to come. As we all know, low vision has been an integral aspect of optometry for years, and we all have been familiar with the need for a proper low vision reabilitation services. Well, today with us, we have an expertise on low vision who will for sure enlighten our knowledge on low vision through their powerful insights. For that, I would now like to inaugurate the session by welcoming our dignitaries for today. And also, I would like to let you all know that we'll be having our discussion session at the end of the webinar. So if you get any queries in between the session, just drop them out on our comment section. We assure you to get back to you later. All right, our first dignitary for this afternoon is Dr. Krishna Priya Kodavati. She is a low vision consultant currently doing her clinical practice in LVPI since 2017 and also have been working in special need vision for multiple disabled children since 2 years. We also have another dignitary for today, Ms. Aishwarya Pillai, who is a low vision rehabilitation counselor at LVPI. And our dignitaries will be talking particularly about assistive technology for low vision and conventional low vision devices. Hello, Dr. Kodavati and Ms. Aishwarya.
Yes.
Welcome to you for this session. Thank you so much for your presence.
Yeah. I can start now?
Yeah, now it's over to you. Please proceed.
Yeah. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for your warm welcome, Solu. So today I'm going to talk about conventional SS2 devices. So first of all, what is SS2 devices? So if we think SS2 devices refers to that which helps the individual to compensate for effect of any disability. It can be hearing aid for those who are having hearing impairment. It can be like wheelchair for those who are having problem in walking. Like that, if we see in our low vision, those who are unable to see better or read. For them, we are using a SS2 device called magnifiers. That is also a SS2 device. So in this session, I'm going to, there are three different types of devices, optical, electronic, and non-optical. Basically, now I'm going to cover two devices, that is optical and non-optical devices. So these are the most conventional low vision devices we use in the clinic. So first of all, optical devices, it is for intermediate distance and near vision devices. Firstly, for intermediate and distance activities, telescopes are the major ones we'll use for distance tasks. So how the telescope works? First of all, we'll discuss how telescope works. A focal system used to magnify distance or intermediate task. So a focal system is nothing but parallel rays of light enter the telescope from an infinitely distant object and parallel rays leaving the telescope from a final image at infinity. This is a focal system which uses in the telescope. This is the principle of a telescope. We'll see what is the advantages of telescope. It gives a variable working distance and monocular or a binocular device and spectacle mounted or handheld means it can be in a spectacle model or in a handheld. So if you see in the pictures below, there are two different kinds. One is the spectacle mounted. The first picture is a spectacle mounted telescope and second one is the monocular handheld telescope. And in the specific task we uses these telescopes. First one is copying from the board and second is identifying street signs and shop names and for watching TV and recognizing faces, reading text on computer screen. But these all at the fixed distance. If someone, the target, whatever you are seeing is moving, it will be not useful for you to use a telescope. And the whatever you are seeing in the pictures, there are three different telescopes. The first one, whatever they stand, that is the monocular handheld telescope. Below one is the binocular spectacle, whichever they are using a computer. And the next is the spectacle mounted telescope, but it is a, there are two types of telescopes. One is Galilean telescope, the other one is Keplerian. But I'm not going to deep into the options of those, but there are different types which we use us in the clinic. And what are the disadvantages of telescope? It restricts the field of view and restricted light gathering properties, and focusing require coordination. If someone is having problem in balancing and the coordination between the eye and a hand, then they may be problematic for them to use a telescope. Some of the, I can tell about those who are having CVI or some those diagnoses. Some people may have this balancing issues and all. For those, it will be difficult for you because they have to catch with a hand. And next, we will go to the near vision devices, that are optical devices, but which uses for near vision. So first one is spectacle mounted telescope. It's just a, we use a convex lenses for the magnification purpose. So if we see the distance changes for the spectacle magnifier and what how it makes. So if you see, if a person is using a spectacle magnifier longer period with a higher dioptric power, let's take a 12 diopter spectacle magnifier and he is using, he should be focusing at the reading material at almost, you can think of 8 point or 9.5. So for those who are using the closer working distance, they may have these convergence related issues. It's like longer the period you hold the target at the closer working distance, they have these astenopic symptoms because of the over convergence for longer period. So for overcoming that issue, we can think of a basin prisms. We use this in the regular clinic with the help in the spectacle magnifiers. That is how you use a basin prism is because the image forms towards the apex, we use the basin prisms to make the image eyes diverge. So it will relax the eyes. So how much power, everyone will be having doubt that how much power we use as the basin prism. So in that scenarios, I'm going to explain you one thing. So generally we use this for every dioptric power, you have to use two prism diopters more than the spectacle power. If you take 12 diopters as a spectacle power, you have to use 14 diopters of basin prism in front of each eye. It's not together. In front of each eye, you have to use 14. It's like norm spectacle power plus 2 diopters is equal to whatever the prism diopters you are going to use in a spectacle. So next, what are the advantages of spectacle magnifiers? It's a psychologically acceptable because the spectacles everyone can use, useful for prolonged reading. And it gives a larger field of view and binocularity is possible. And both hands will be free because it's like a spectacle. They no need to catch with a hand. So both hands will be free. And disadvantages is this will give you shorter working distance. As the power increases, the distance from the eye to the reading material will reduce, and decreased illumination and limited range of magnification. So why it is limited range is because as the power increases, the reading, the distance between the eye and the object reduces. So how long they can focus at the more closer. So the spectacle magnifiers, whatever I am talking about, it's available till plus 12. It can be available more than that. But mostly we use this in the clinic from my experience, I'm telling, if it is more than 12 diopters, patient may not be acceptable because it gives the more closer to the face. So they may not be accept these higher powers in the spectacles. So there are some other magnifiers which can we can keep it in, hold it in a hand, that is handheld magnifiers. So basically these are also a convex lens that is held by means of a handle at various distances from reading plane. So the principle of all plus lenses magnifiers is identically the magnification remains constant regardless of the eye to magnify distance. So providing that the object is placed at the anterior focal point. This gives the option of taking the plus lens and placing it in a mounting or perhaps with a handle and holding it away from the eye. There are literally hundreds of different designs of hand magnifiers to choose from, but it's freely available from different sources. There are different sources. We can use these magnifiers, and basically it's like a spot reading or a needle work, or if you want to see a mobile, or which can be helpful for a spot reading, you can use of these magnifiers. There are wide range of magnifiers with a different models. I'm showing you in the pictures. There are different models of handheld magnifiers. So let's see what is the advantages and disadvantages of this. So advantages of handheld magnifier is it gives variable eye lens distance and may have its own light source. And it is convenient for spot reading. As I told you, just if you go to the shop, if you someone wants to see a price of that material, then it can be useful. It's like a spot reading which helps you to read, and it is easily available in any different markets. It's like you have to buy it from this company or that company. It's not like that. You can buy it from any other different sources. And disadvantages of handheld magnifiers is both hands are occupied because you are catching a magnifier with one hand and the reading material with the other hand, and slow and uncomfortable for prolonged reading and must be held at correct focal distance to obtain maximum power. Unsuitable for patients with tremor and arthritis, because if someone is having arthritis and tremors, they may have these issues, because holding a magnifier for longer period in hand with a constant focal distance, that will be difficult for them to use for longer period. So having the problem in the positioning, it's very critical, and slight alterations in object distance can produce large changes in the vergence of light leading the magnifier, usually creating a noticeably blurred image for the patient. So casually inspection of the view through the magnifier illustrates that this very limited depth of field, but a possible solution to the problem of maintaining the precise magnifier to object distance is to place the magnifier lens on a stand to fix that position. So from there, we got a stand magnifier. So what it does is the convex lenses mounted at a fixed distance. In this view, it gives a stand with a fixed distance of the focal distance from the reading material. Just they have to keep it on a reading material and read it. And there are advantages for this. That is, it gives a focus. Like you see in the pictures, there is a stand at the, you can observe the stand. So that gives a focal distance. Directly, they can keep it on the book and read it. It is available in the illuminated or non-illuminated. So may have its own light source. It is portable. They can take it to anywhere. It is easy to use because no need to held it constant at one focal point because it's already available in a stand form that constant focal distance. So these are the advantages. And if we see the advantages of stand magnifier is reduce the field of view and poor posture unless reading stand is used. Reading illumination in case of non-illuminated stand magnifiers and requires either accommodation or addition to use this stand magnifier. Why I am saying is accommodation or addition is, it's because you have to think about the object, the magnifier to object distance. So if we see, think of a presbyopes needs a reading addition, or the pre-presbyope needs to accommodate. So in order to use a fixed focus stand magnifier, the degree of accommodation required depends on the design of the magnifier. So and the distance of the magnifier lens from the eye. So in this, you are using a stand magnifier at the reading material, so it will alter the accommodation. So you have to use an addition or an accommodation to make it fix clear. So and the next one is I am going to discuss about the non-optical devices. So it is nothing but devices which improves functional vision when used with or without optical devices. It can be with optical devices or only the giving the non-optical device may help in improving the functional vision. So there is difference between functional vision and visual function. So visual function is what we assess, like optometrist or any ophthalmologist will assess in the clinics, that is visual acuity, visual field, color, color vision, contrast sensitivity, and stereopsis. But functional vision is what they are able to do in the regular daily activities. So that is functional vision. So with the non-optical devices, we can improve their functional vision when used with or without optical devices. So basically, there are four different types of non-optical devices I'm going to discuss, that is related to size and larger SS2 devices, and glare, contrast, and lighting control devices, and posture and comfort maintenance devices, and handwriting and written communication devices. So first of and orientation and mobility management techniques and sensory substitution devices and medical management and life skills are extra, which we can suggest them to use in the daily life. So first one, I am going to discuss about the relative size and larger SS2 devices. So there are example relative size magnification, we can call it as the relative size, that is large print thing. If you see the pictures here, it shows you the reader's digest and dictionaries, large telephone dial and playing cards with a larger font. So these all are the large print books. It's like a, you are making the reading reading materials size, the letters, whatever it is, it's increasing, that is related to size magnification. And the disadvantages of this is heavier. It is too heavy to means. If someone is using a normal font, can cover a book in one book. So those who are using a relative to size magnification in the notebooks, they may need at least 2 to 3 books more. So that is bulkier and heavier, and it is less available. It's not available for all books. Some books may have these size large prints. Some may not be having these large prints. That are the disadvantages of this. And it is available till the large print books. You can do it for 2x or 2.5x, not more than that. It's because if you are doing more than that, that will be discomfort for those who are having field loss or something, because for them to cover a single sentence or single word, it will be difficult if you are giving a more than 2x magnification in the larger print materials. And here, if you see glare, contrast, and lighting control. So I'm discussing here glare, contrast, and lighting. So the first picture, if you see glare, at the first picture, the girl, the child is having the problem in opening the eyes, so she always squeezes her eyes. So when we are keeping a filter or a tinted glasses, which helps her to open her eyes, in that you see in the picture, the filter helping to open. This is one of the glare control. So other non-optical device you can think of is a umbrella or a cap while going outside. And second and next one is contrast. So it suggests the child, those who are having visual impairments and poor contrast. It's like in some of the cases, you are seeing the glaucoma cases, the vision can be better, but the contrast may reduce or visual field can reduce. In such, if such person is having reduced contrast, they can think of using this type of doors, like in a handle with a different color and the cupboard with a different color, but it should be in a better contrast. If you see here the stairs, So what it the difference between right and left stairs is at the edges of the each stair they used a black color marking so to identify where is the next step and where is the step end point. So it will help them to use it in the daily activities, and the proper navigation will be helpful with the increase a bit of contrast in the daily activities. And the next one is enhancing by improving the lighting controls in the home or while reading, using a overhead reading lamp can help them. So these are the glare, contrast and lighting control device. So next is posture and comfort maintenance. So that is, it provides comfortable body posture while reading at closer working distance. So while you are prescribing a stand magnifier or a spectacle magnifier, you have to suggest them to use a reading stand because when they are keeping closer, using a reading stand gives a better body posture as compared to without a reading stand while using a spectacle or stand magnifier. And there are some devices, handwriting and written communication devices. So there are reading guide here, letter writer, check guide and signature guide. If you see the bigger one with the more boxes, that is a letter guide. Ask them to keep a letter there and read it or write it. Letter writer. It's like they can write it where they're seeing a white color space. So they have to write in that. And a typoscope that gives you wherever the space you are having to. If someone is having confusion between first line and second line, they can use a typoscope to read the material. And check guide is available and the signature guide. Ask wherever they have to keep a signature and place the signature guide over there and ask them to sign it in the signature guide. So it will it will come in a same line. It will not go up and down or something. It will be clear signature they can keep. So these are the handwriting and written communication devices, but it needs some training to use it. And while using this, you can think of asking them to use a different high contrast gel pens, or we will call it a felt tip pen. So that helps in improve the contrast of the ink, whatever they're using. And as I told you, felt tip pen, handwriting felt tip pen. And if you someone children is using a pencil, then you can think of a 3B pencil. 3B pencil or HB pencil, which gives a darker color as compared to remaining pencils. And while suggesting to the parents, you can think, you can suggest the parents to increase the lines. If you are in the, if you see the child is using a bold line notebook, so if someone is having difficulty to identify the lines in between, ask the parents to make it or darker than what is there. So that will help them to increase the, enhance the clearance of the space between each line. So that will be helpful in their education. So these are the handwriting and written communication devices. And if you think of orientation and mobility techniques and devices. So here there are different techniques. There is mobility cane and sighted cane. Mobility cane is for individual use. No one is helping you to use the mobility. No one is helping you to walk. So cane is nothing but to use to walk independently by yourself. The sighted guide technique. If you are seeing the first picture, the sighted guide technique. Someone is helping you to walk. So there are some techniques to use. I'm not going to deep into that. You can go to the website and read about this sighted guide techniques and mobility canes. And there are some sensory substitution devices, hearing and tactual. So hearing is nothing but audiobooks. So they have to use a recorder to listen to the whatever the material. So that is one. And tactually is a braille. If someone is visually impaired, so they can think of braille lippy can use. So I think everyone knows what is Braille Lippi. So I'm not going to deep into that. And next, the medical management devices, preset insulin syringe, this is a setup. They have to know how to use this and talking glucometer. If someone is using a glucometer, there is also available talking glucometer that will help you understand what is the values you got, that is talking glucometer. And life skill device, that is matching. One is talking watch and color identifiers. So if you are seeing here, there is buttons. Each button represents each color. So when someone is choosing a color for them to identify at the edge of every dress, they will be having each button. With the shape of that button, they will identify which color the dress sees. So based on that, they have to train which symbol represents which color. So based on that, they will identify which color they are used basically. And talking watch, it's nothing but it gives the reading output to us. And some other is a needle threader. One, if you see the below picture, it's a needle and threader, extra instrument. It's like a non-optical devices. They have to use a needle and threader device here. And Notex, there are steps here. Maybe it's the Notex what I'm presenting here for the old notes, means previous notes, but the new Notex we are going to prepare for the new notes like 2000 and all, but it's not available at present. It depends. If you see the step by step, it's like a staircase, right? So if you see that there is a, each stair belongs to one, it is a 5 rupee note, 10 rupee note, 100, 1000. It's like that. So based on this principle, we are making a new for the Notex for new notes, currency notes. And last but not least, there are variable focus telescopes that is called bioptics. You can use not here abroad, they are using it driving as so the variable focus. Previously only manual focus, but it's available variable focus. You can automatically focus for you wherever you see. But tried it, so I don't know how it will work when you are using automatic focus for patient. Manual is definitely helpful for its variable distance. You can focus it from 30 centimeters to infinity. It's like one telescope gives you all forms of tasks you can do with the bioptic telescope. Thank you. So I'm not going to talk about the electronic device.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for such a wonderful presentation. Do you hear me?
Yes, Solu. So just talk about Aishwarya, you can.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's begin with the next talk.
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yeah, ma'am. Yeah.
Yeah. Good afternoon, everyone. I hope you all are having a wonderful day there. Well, I'm going to talk about assistive technology for persons with vision loss. So what is assistive technology? Before we know that, I just want to just say that, a few years ago when the technology came in, the persons with vision loss were not able to use it at all because it was only meant for sighted people. But now, because of the advent of assistive technology, persons with vision loss are able to not only just able to use it, but enhancing their livelihood with the advent of this technology. So going to my second slide, what is assistive technology? So supposing we have heard of technology, but what is assistive technology? Anything that assists somebody to live an independent life, or it gives a new adaptation to whatever they're living with, or any rehabilitation tool, these fall under the assistive technology. And what is slide 3? what does assistive technology do? First of all, it helps one in daily living skills. Like, you know, somebody, you know, if I want to make a simple call, imagine you had your phone and if you were blindfolded, how would you use the phone? So assistive technology helps us use the phone without our sight. Then it helps us to be independent. The technology has advanced so much that, you know, there's so many applications that are coming up for visually impaired, not just, you know, Braille and cane are the old school ones, but nowadays the technology, you know, there's so many things, you know, if I want to take a photograph and have it read out to me, assistive technology helps me out. And these are the ways in which the assistive technology helps me. It enhances my ability further. So those are the uses of assistive technology. Then let's have a look at the types of assistive technology now. So coming to the screen readers. So I don't know if you all know, but right now I am visually impaired. I cannot see, but right now I have a laptop in front of me and I'm using a screen reader to see what my slides are showing. So I'm actually talking to you all, but I have the other earphones in which the screen reader is talking to me and telling me that I'm on the fourth slide and this is about the screen readers on computer. So it talks to me, like there's a software that is, you know, sometimes some are like paid ones, some are open source where you don't have to pay anything. They just need to, whoever is visually impaired, they need to install this software into the computer. And it reads out everything to them. Like I have listed out some of the names of these softwares, if you can see. And it helps me do all the work. Like if I want to type in MS Office, Word, PowerPoint, Excel, and also advanced things like browsing, emailing, then, you know, shopping sites like Amazon. I want to open my YouTube channel, I can do that. I want to pay something online, I can do that. So these are the things that these screen readers helps me do it. So we at LV Prasad Institute, we have a assistive technology center where we train persons with vision loss on how to use these screen readers with computers. It's a 3 month training course. And in this they learn how to, you know, from basics like typing, you know, learning the keyboard layout, you know, all for sighted, they'll see the letters. Oh, this is A, this is B. But how about visually impaired? So when they press the letter, the screen reader reads out to them what they are. So that's how they're able to navigate the computer. And then once they get into the advanced, they also, you know, get into different, learning different computer languages. And finally, after they, you know, based on their interest, of course. And finally, when they learn this, then they are, you know, placed in suitable jobs. So that way they become independent. So I'm moving on to the next screen. So hold on. Screen readers for smartphones. So what is the screen reader for smartphones? Similarly, similar to the screen readers that we have on the computers, there are screen readers on smartphones as well. So either the iOS or the Android platform, there are inbuilt screen readers. Like these options are available in, you know, you can, after this session, you can actually go to your settings and there would be an option called accessibility. So once you look into that option, you'll find something for the iOS users, you will have an option called voiceover. And for Android users, you will have an option called talkback. So once you switch it on, your phone will start talking to you. So that is how we are able to use our phones. So right from basics such as, you know, calling up, messaging, or if you need to, you know, use some application, even using things like, you know, we are all into Insta, Twitter, Facebook, and WhatsApp. So, you know, even persons with vision loss are also able to use these applications without any problem using these screen readers. So at the end of the session, I will have you, or right now, like I will actually play how the screen reader sounds. this is my iPhone, and I'm going to this. So the screen reader that I'm going to use is called VoiceOver. So please let me know if you all can hear this.
Password field, 06, now is entered. Secure text field.
Are you all able to hear this?
2, 3.
Yes, I sure you.
5, 6.
It is reading out to me.
9, 0.
So it is asking me to enter my password. So if
enter passcode. Touch ID does not recognize your fingerprint. Passcode field. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 0. Emergency. Cancel. Button.
So whatever it did right now, I was just swiping from left to right, and it read out to me that, you know, it is asking me to enter the password. So once I enter the password, I will be able to use all the applications on my phone. So this is how the screen readers on the phones work. And if you all have any doubt about, or if you want to know more about these screen readers, you can actually contact us and we'll be able to help you all more on this. And moving off to the next one, screen magnifiers for smartphone. So this the screen readers are usually for the ones who cannot see anything at all on the screen. They are not able to see the font, nothing at all. But some people, they have low vision, provided, like, you know, some if the screen is magnified enough, they're able to see what's on the screen. So similar to the screen readers, the screen magnifier option is also available in the accessibility menu. So using this option, they can magnify the screen. So then after that, they're able to see the font size, the image, everything they're able to see. So this is how the screen magnifiers are helpful for those who have low vision. Now I'm going to the next slide. It's the text readers. I've listed out, I'm not reading out what is there on the slide, the softwares, what are there, but I will explain to you all what are text readers. So I go to a restaurant, imagine, what is the first thing we all do? We all read out the menu in front of us. What is there, you know, under the non-veg column, under the veg column. But what about people, you know, who have vision loss and then they go there? They either have to be dependent on the waiter or somebody beside them if they can read out the menu. But what these text readers do, these are the applications that are made for people with vision loss. So once these applications are downloaded, you can point out the camera at these, you know, at the text that's in front of you and take a picture. And it processes the picture and reads out what is there in the menu. So you can not just do it for the food menu. You can do this, like, if you want to know your Aadhaar card number, or if you want to know what is there in the newspaper, or if there's a sheet in front of you and you don't know what is there in that. So you just need to take a picture and it will read out what is there in that picture. So these are called text reader apps. There are paid ones as well as free ones. So you can explore it and you can recommend it to the person with vision loss who come to you all. Moving on, the next one. Image reader apps. So image reader, what it does, so I want to know when I get into a room, I mean, it's the first time I'm getting into a room and I don't know what is there in front of me. Like, example, you all get into a conference hall, you know, okay, the chairs are there, the stage is there, the podium is towards the right side of the stage, the entrance is, you know, towards the back side. So how about a visually impaired person? How will they know all this? So that is when these image reading apps come into picture. So they take a picture and this app will read out to them what is there in the picture. Like, example, if I take a picture of people sitting in a conference room, it will say people sitting across a table in a conference room. So that is a description it will give me. It may not be accurate, like 100% accurate, but it will give me an idea of what the room is and what are my surroundings. So this is how the image readers are helpful for me. Moving on, navigation apps. So navigation apps are very important. Like all of you may be already knowing about Google Maps. What it does when you go somewhere, it reads out to you. I mean, you can, if you give it a destination, it will take you to that destination. It will tell you take right, take left. So this is one of the navigation apps. But besides that, there are some navigation apps which tells me where I exactly am. Like if I'm on the road and then I click on where am I, it will tell me you're on so-and-so road and this is the road number so-and-so, this is this colony and this is this city. And some apps are so advanced that it will also give the latitude and the longitude coordinates of where I am exactly. So it's such a cool thing. And there's one called ID app. What it does is, besides just giving me where I am, it also tells me what's around. So supposing, in fact, it will be useful even for the sighted people, because if you all go to a new city and you want to go to a proper restaurant, so using this app, you can actually click on what's around. So it will tell you what are the places around. There is a McDonald's on the right side. There's KFC on the left side. So these are the things it will tell me. So, and once I click on that, then it connects me to Google Map. Then I can go to that place using the Google Map. So these are called navigation apps. Next one is the volunteer assistance apps. What do they do? So sometimes we do need somebody's help. Applications are not that accurate. We cannot be 100% dependent on them. So we have this volunteers app, which connect us to volunteers through a video call. So I've listed out two. It is, one is called Be My Eyes. In fact, if you all are interested in this, you yourself can be a volunteer. Look up for Be My Eyes and register yourself as a volunteer. And what you need to do is, you may get a call from a visually impaired person, and it will be a video call, and they'll ask you for help. They'll say, can you please read out what is there in this card? Or something like, I dropped my, you know, keychain. Can you please help me where it is? So all you need to do is, when they point out the camera at that particular point, you need to guide them. Okay, move to your right, move to your left, move up, or whatever is there in front of them, you can just read it out. And the difference between Be My Eyes and Aira is nothing but, Aira has professionals who would be guiding the people. I mean, they would have been trained and they would be guiding the people. Be My Eyes, anybody can be a volunteer. So the next one, color identifier. So if I want to know, like, you know, obviously when you all dress up, you all can see the color. Okay, today is, you know, nice sunny day. So I'm going to wear a chill out color. I'm going to wear blue. So supposing, how about when we want to select colors and when there's no one around? So that is when we make use of these apps. We take this app, take the dress, click the picture, and it will say it is blue or it will say it is yellow. So that is how these color identifier apps help us. And moving on further, library apps. So if I'm interested in listening to audiobooks, you know, there's so many, you know, for even for sighted people, there are audiobooks, libraries such as Audible, Kindle and all. So similarly, we also have some audiobooks apps from where we can download and listen to this audiobooks. And further, recreational apps. So sometimes, you know, we get confused, like what kind of, you know, if somebody wants to play, you know, we think, oh, maybe it's just the chess or something like that. But even visually impaired people have something called audio games. You know, everything is audio. You know, like there's one game I remember, it's called The Blind Legend. So what it does is, you're the player and you have to put two earphones, and you'll have villains, the enemies attacking you from left and right and straight. So you have to attack depending upon where you can hear the noise. Supposing the arrow is coming from the left, you have to attack on the left. So this is, like, you know, an interesting game for children. Similarly, you have blind cricket, and also you have audio described movies. What are audio described movies? So you go and watch a movie in the theater or in the television. So how about those scenes where there's no description? I mean, if I'm watching a movie, I would not know what is happening in the scene. So some movies these days are coming up with description. By default, they're coming up with description. I mean, this feature is incorporated in Netflix. So it reads out to me, it describes to me what's happening in the scene. So this is one of the things, the audio description. And so audiobooks, audio description, audio movies, these are some of the recreational activities. Braille tools. So what are Braille tools? Like mentioned by Krishna Priya, like we have this Braille, Braille is the language that visually impaired use. So we have this Braille embossers. Braille embossers are nothing but, you know, when you want to the text to be printed in Braille, that's when you use Braille embossers. Braille typewriters, then Braille slates. So these are just nothing but through the devices through which you can read, write, and make use of Braille. Moving on. Scanning tools. So what are the scanning tools? So scanning tools are nothing but I can scan the document. Like, you know, these are professional, like if I want a scanned copy of, say, my certificate or a passport, I take a picture, it converts it to a PDF or a Word document, and then I can save it in my phone. So these are the scanning tools, which are very useful for me. And I can save it, and whenever I want it the next time, it will help me, get to the document. Not only that, these days, there are some, advanced tools which can scan barcodes and QR code readers. You all may be knowing barcodes already. You know, when you go to the stores, you have those people at the counter scanning the barcodes, and then you would have all the information in the computer. Similarly, the QR codes also work the same way. So it will help, like, you know, if I want to know something, some information about, you know, something in front of me, if there's a barcode, I can take a picture and it will give all its information to me in my phone. So this is how these scanning tools work. Moving ahead. Audio tools, like Krishna Priya already said, you know, spoke to you about audiobooks. Like, you know, we have books like, you know, MP3 books, Daisy books. So these are just, you know, they're just recorded for us and we listen to them and we make use of them. Wearable technology. So we have, you know, the technology is advancing so much that you might have heard of Google Glasses or OrCam, eSight. So this is something like you have to wear it, on your eyes. And then when you look around, you know, it will give you a description of what's around, or it magnifies the surroundings so that you can see what's around. But of course, the usage of this is only limited. People maybe with low vision will be able to use it, or these devices are usually very expensive. The eSight device that I've listed there, it's almost more than 1 lakh Indian rupees. What's the currency in Nepal? Hello,
ma'am.
What's the currency called in Nepal?
It's rupees, ma'am.
Rupees itself. Okay. So it will read out, the OrCam. I mean, it's about over 1 lakh Indian rupees. That's how much eSight costs. So people in Asia and Africa, the developing countries, may not be able to afford such expensive devices. Moving on, then this last one is the handheld devices. So you have things like cane and torchit. Torchit is nothing but a vibrating piece of device that you have to tag to your cane. So whenever there's an obstacle, it tells you, okay, there's an obstacle. Similarly, that's how a smart cane works. Smart cane is also an attachable device to your cane. It gives you vibration. If there's an obstacle in front of you, it gives you vibration. Then there's the ocean. Ocean gives you sound. It does not vibrate, but it gives you sound. The closer the obstacle is, the frequency of the sound is high. So these are some of the handheld devices. Then the last slide, of course, the ultimate goal of assistive technology is to make a person independent. Right now, I finished this presentation only because of, you know, assistive technology. I was looking at the computer, listening to the screen reader, and I was also using my phone that I'm connected to Zoom. And this is again through screen reader. That's how I was able to present it. And most of my work at my workplace, I use doing the screen reader. Not just me, my other colleagues also, they work using these screen readers. And people all around the world, you know, persons with vision loss, they're able to use the screen readers and be as independent as they can be. Thank you so much. I'm done with my presentation.
Thank you so much, Ms. Aishwarya, for gracing us with your invaluable insights.
You're welcome, Salu.
Well, now it's time for the discussion session to begin.
Are you ready to take the questions?
Yes. Yes,
yes. More interactive, I would like to request both of our presenters to share their video with the audience. Can you? It's not mandatory, but if it's visible, you can.
Yeah, I would prefer without the video, Sulu.
Yeah, ma'am, sure.
Yeah.
Now let me check out the questions that our audience might have raised. I will read out the questions for you.
Mr. Monish Chaudhary have asked, can you please explain the impact of Amsler grid on low vision for prescription?
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Did you hear my question?
Yes. How the Amsler grid... Hello?
Yes, ma'am. Impact of Amsler grid on low vision prescription.
First of all, previously one more talk happened by Mr. Deepak Bagga. He explained about central vision loss, peripheral vision loss, and overall blurred vision. So when you are knows about, it's mostly not low vision devices. Sometimes when you are prescribing a device, may not be helpful for the patient. It's because of the whatever the vision loss they are having. So in that scenarios, it may helpful to find out. Amsler grid will help you to find out which type of, like if someone is having central scotoma and you are giving a stand magnifier to read, maybe they will be unable to read if their magnification is lesser, means the required magnification is less, then also they may not be able to read. So in that scenarios, you to find out what is the reason for them to not unable to use the magnifier, Amsler grid will helpful for the further confirmation. Understood?
Well, we have another question. Mr. Mohan Rao, he has addressed that two specific things are of primary challenge for practitioner, and he has dropped his two questions. The question goes as, what are the list of institutions or places which provide low vision referrals, and what are the companies that provide low vision devices?
It's like institutions, I think in India, like 6 or 7 institutions, I know, not more than that. And components, repeat the next question. So I should name the institutions, what it is like. First one is L.V. Prasada Institute. Next one is in Delhi, AIIMS. And there are some other clinics like Soham Clinic. There are some institutions which provides low vision. So sometimes it's we will refer the patients, those who are nearer to those places also. And the second question, can you repeat once again, Solu?
Yeah, ma'am. The The next question goes as, what are the companies that provide low vision devices?
There are different components we have to see. The basically first is what is the need of patient is the first thing we have to think of. Like if someone wants to read a reading material or something, then you can think of magnifiers. So you have to first need of the patient to know, you should know. And second is what magnification patient require and what are the functional problems they are having and medical health. And the last one is whether that will be helpful in a spectacle or choosing a device, it will be helpful. So there are many components which gives like what is the refractive error of the patient and what is the accommodation status and whether these all will come into picture when you are choosing a device, low vision devices. So these all components we have to keep in mind while selecting.
Ma'am, thank you so much. And we have another question as, can you please explain about eSight device?
Aishwarya, you will go further with the eSight device. Aishwarya?
Okay. Is my audio muted?
Yeah, you can. We can hear you. You can go ahead.
Okay. So eSight is a device by Mr. Rob Hilkes. That's his company from Canada. So for eSight device, it's a wearable. It's like a spectacles, but it has, you know, additional components to it. So for that, a person has to be, you know, they need to have visual acuity and, you know, they have given out like this would be the visual acuity and this, you know, there's some criteria is there for somebody to use eSight. Not everybody will be able to use eSight. So those people will be able to use eSight. So once they wear, so the surroundings around them are magnified. I mean, they look clear. So that's how they'll be able to use it and wear it.
So eSight basically...
You can actually also look up for eSight.
In the website, yeah. eSight website. So eSight can be used by a legally blind person, not the totally blind people. Because it magnifies the...
Okay. So ma'am, is it any... patients are using the such type of devices in India?
India, there is right now no one is buying it because we had the person come here to our country, I mean, at LV Prasad and show us the device. But as soon as we say it is this expensive, people are not willing to buy. Like it, like I said, it costed like over 1 lakh Indian rupees. So, you know, they're like, no, we, but of course, in abroad, many people are using this device called eSight.
Okay, that's perfect, ma'am. In the other countries, there are the provision of insurance for the such type of people. Actually, in our Nepal, if you see the patient with the low vision, actually, they are more getting the problems with the finance and money. Even they want to take a best care vision, they wouldn't because they have the problem with like regularly expand about the money they have to buy the different devices and they have to worry about for the expenditure. So in your country, is there any provision to help the such type of patients or if you saw the such type of patients and how we can tackle with this in this situation?
Krishnabhaiya, could I answer this?
So yes, anything is fine.
Okay. Here in India, we have a monthly pension for disabled people, which is 3,000 Indian rupees per month. But besides this, there are schemes from the government, both the central and the state governments, that some devices will be given as a part of a scheme. So we have devices like Daisy Reader, cane, the smart canes, laptops, and smartphones. These are given as part of a scheme. But the beneficiary, whoever is applying for these schemes, they have to be of low income group, and they need to submit their income certificate, their Aadhaar card, as well as their disability certificate. Only when they match the criteria, when they are, then they are eligible to avail these schemes. But for the others, they may not be able to avail these schemes. Does that answer your question?
Okay, perfect. Krishna, PRE ma'am, would you like to add something?
Yeah, tell me.
Okay, in the same thing, would you like to, yes, in the same thing, do you like to put some views? Okay,
I didn't get your question.
Yes. Okay, ma'am. I'm asking, do you want to put some view on the same topic? I guess we had answered this question. Okay. So, Soli, is there any other questions?
Yeah, we have another questions, and the question goes as, can you please explain about Coursewell software?
What software?
Coursewell.
Okay, Coursewell software, what it does is it converts the text, like, if I want a braille printout, okay, from my computer, and I have a Word document with the regular English text. So what this Coursewell software does, it converts the English text into braille. So after that, I can take a printout of the braille format using a braille embosser. So I don't have to keep writing each braille cell with that. It directly, if I have the Word document, it converts it into braille, and then I can take a printout. That's where the Coursewell software is used.
Thank you, ma'am, for your answer. And we have another question, and the question goes as, can you please explain how is an advanced low vision examination different from a regular eye routine examination?
There is no advanced and regular. So basically, at the first, we have to think of affordability of the patient. Is all whatever I told is like, which gives with the optical and non-optical. If you think advanced, I can think of electronic magnifiers, which are not helpful with the optical devices. Okay. So whatever I'm telling is optical and non-optical is like uses in the regular clinic. But if someone who is unable to use these optical and non-optical devices, they can think of a electronic magnifier that is very costly, like a portable. I give some examples like portable video magnifier or desktop magnifier. These are the advanced I can think of. But whatever I told is like a normal thing, but advanced is electronic magnifiers. These all will come into picture.
Okay, ma'am, thank you so much for your answer. Thus far, these are all the questions that have been raised by our audience, and I guess we have answered most of the questions till now. Considering the time limits, your announcement of the discussion session, I would again like to express my immense gratitude towards both of our presenters for today, and as well to all the attendees for their endurance. Also, I would like to thank all the direct and indirect helping hands for this ITUX program. Before wrap up, I would like to request our today's presenter to share their few words to our program. Let's begin with Dr. Kodavati.
Yeah, thank you for this opportunity. Very less experience I have because I started the low vision
practice since 3 years, I guess. So this is very less, but whatever I know, I explained. So if something they know, they can comment in the YouTube channel so I can go through that. Okay. Thank you for this opportunity. Thank you for this Miroi Foundation for giving this opportunity to me.
Yeah, on my end, I want to thank each one of you for having us here. It was a wonderful sharing of the knowledge with you all. And I just want to reiterate that if you have any queries about assistive technology or how it will be useful for persons with vision loss, or if you have anyone, you know, coming to you and saying, we need training on this, you know, we need smartphone training or computer training, anything like that, even coming to the apps, you can always inform us. Mr. Kapil here, you know, we could share our, I think he already has an email ID. He can always contact us and tell us that, you know, there's a requirement here. So y'all can write to us and yeah, that's all. Have a good day, all of you. Thank you for having us.
So last, hello.
Hello, ma'am, please proceed.
Yeah, so I will give some numbers to Kapil. If he wants any doubts or something, he can contact to that and he can give it to one of you to contact us. That is okay?
Yeah, ma'am, sure. Now we are to the end of our today's webinar. Thanks to both of our presenters, and herewith I announce the closure of today's webinar, hoping to see you all again tomorrow with a brand new topic. Stay safe, stay connected. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Have a good day.